So, embracing smallness. This is not something I'm familiar with, as some people call me a giant on this. But those of you who are short, maybe you can fill me in on this. No, okay, all right. So not the smallness we're talking about here today, but embracing smallness is the idea of God's purpose, and his plan is best, and no matter what that is, large or small. Now, we're going to be in Acts chapter 8, and you can go there. I'm going to start with a passage in 1 Corinthians, and then I'll get over to Acts chapter 8 here real soon. But chapter 1 of 1 Corinthians, start in verse 18, it says this: "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God." Okay? Now, the world will look at the preaching of the cross and look at that and go, yeah, why even bother? That's foolishness. And to us, we know that without the cross and without the resurrection, there is no power of salvation. For it is written, "I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent." Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that, in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. And so he said, I'm going to use preaching. And he said, I'm not going to use the most powerful. I'm not going to use the biggest name. He says in verse 25, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God hath chosen the foolish things of this world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. The base things of the world, the things which are despised, God hath chosen, yea, and the things which are not, to bring to naught the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. We know that we are called of Christ, and that whatever Christ calls us to do, we should embrace that.
That's right.
Now, we would all love to have our name in lights, because that's what our flesh would love. Our names to be recognized, to have the appreciation of all, to be able to be seen as doing the job that we did. And yet, God doesn't do that in many different situations. Now, God can take something that is humble and someone that is humble, and he can exalt that, and the Bible says, in his due time. But oftentimes, we want to be exalted. And we want to be doing the great things and the big things and the wonderful things for the Lord. Now, I'm not saying we shouldn't have a desire to serve the Lord or to do great things for God. But what we must realize is it is God's work that does it. And so if God calls us to a place that we're going to be big, maybe a big fish in a small pond, or God calls us to be the nobody on the backside of the desert that he did with many of the people in the Bible, like Moses or the Apostle Paul, or like we'll look at today, Philip. It is God's work that is important. And when we talk about gospel identity, we talk about it getting into the areas of the gospel identity allows me to get lost in what God has called me to do rather than competing or comparing or trying to get recognition from others. It causes me to turn, we said. It causes me to look upward, we said. And today we're talking about the identity that grows a resilience when we don't necessarily see the end result, or we don't see the recognition from others, or we don't necessarily see the purpose immediately for why God called us to do what he's called us to do. And so today, if you're in Acts, I'm going to go there. Acts chapter 8. That's Ephesians. I have no clue where I'm going. There we go. Acts chapter 8. We're going to see somebody by Philip who has seen both the large, what we might call mega church ministry today, and the one-on-one ministry that God called him to do. And Philip is an interesting character. We're in chapter 8. Of this, and so let's look at it. It says that Saul was consenting unto his death, that time there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. They were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Now, if you were to go back to chapter 1 and verse 8, you would see that that's what God was beginning to call them to do, was to go out into Judea and Samaria and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Now, they had been in Jerusalem at this time. They had stayed in one location, and now God is using persecution to grow the church. He's using persecution to spread the church. Okay? The church thrives in persecution. And so when we start to see laws that are made, and there was a law that was passed this last week on what they're calling the Respect of Marriage Act, that really it is against churches what it's trying to do. You look at the public school system that is trying to, it has for years, and this is nothing new, but it's just, it's more and more and more where they're trying to replace God with humanism and put the humanistic philosophy in place of God, to where you are your own best self, you are your own best person, and then the idea of believe in yourself, trust yourself, remake yourself, and then here's all the ills of why you are such a bad person. Okay, there's a ton of things that are going on in our world that are really aimed at God, the Bible, and the church. And so in that persecution, the church spreads like wildfire. We've already had, we saw last week, 3,000 people, 5,000 people, or 10, 12,000 people in Jerusalem who are saved. And when they are scattered abroad, they take their gospel with them. They take their message with them. So now when we get into Samaria, where Philip goes, and we get into the northern regions and the eastern regions of Syria, down into Egypt, and some of the different areas where they start to spread out, we start to see churches pop up, and we start to see groups of people who know Christ, because as they are persecuted and scattered, they take the gospel with them. They're not ashamed. In fact, they have great boldness to witness for Christ. And so in Acts chapter 8, we have Philip. We have Stephen, who's been buried. They made lamentation over him. Saul is making havoc of the church. He's just coming through with a wrecking ball, entering into every house. He's committing them to prison. This is before Saul becomes Paul. It says they went everywhere preaching the word. And then we get to Philip. It says, then Philip, verse 5, went down to the city of Samaria and preached Christ unto them. Now, if you're a Jewish person, Samaria is not the place you go, because the Samaritans are the despised people by the Jews. They're the half-breeds, okay? They're the people who, they're not full-blooded Jewish people. They worshipped in a different place. They worshipped in a different way, and it was different. It wasn't of God. In fact, they would make great stakes and pain to go around Samaria. Now, Jesus, when he was alive with his disciples, says, I must needs go to Samaria. And there in Sychar, he leads the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman. She goes back to her town. Half the city gets saved. It's amazing what happens. I think that's probably the root of Philip's church here. Okay? When he comes into Samaria, and I love the accuracy of the Bible, where it says he goes down. Okay? Now, some of you are directionally challenged. You have no problem with that. Okay? But for some of you, you're going, wait a minute. It's north. How does he go down? Okay? The idea is elevation. He does go down. Okay? So for those of you going, that's wrong. No, it's not. It's very accurate. Okay, some of you are going, I have no clue what you're talking about. Just continue on. Use your Google Maps, right? So when Philip goes down into Samaria, he's going down in elevation, but he's going north. Okay, and this is not the area that they would go to, but he goes there on purpose. Now, look at the results of this. It says he preached Christ unto them. The people with one accord gave heed unto those things which Philip spake, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. Unclean spirits crying with a loud voice came out of many that were possessed with them, and many taken with palsies that were lame were healed, and there was great joy in that city. And so we see people accepting the gospel. Now we do have some miracles and casting out of demons and healing of people. Early church, remember, they've got these miracles, they've got these signs, they've got these things that are happening. That when we get the completed scriptures, those things that are in part, these miracles, these things like that, those things go away, and the primary primacy of preaching comes forward. That's where 1 Corinthians, the foolishness of preaching confounds the wise, that it saves men. So just know that as we're going through this, if you're going, whoa, what are we talking about here? There were signs and miracles to show the power of the gospel here in the early church, because the Jews required a sign on so many things, and the Samaritans there would have been partly Jewish in their ancestry. Okay, so we see many things, but many people come to Christ. We have a person named Simon. He is a person, a sorcerer, who is bewitching the people. Simon comes to Christ, and he gets saved. And you talk about an explosion of people when they go, Simon got saved. Yeah, we better look at this. We better. So we've got a church that's just exploding at this point of people. And Philip is the one that, as you look at him, you're going, wow, big time ministry. I mean, we're getting hundreds, if not thousands, of people saved, and they're being reached, and whole city is being changed, and everyone knows who Philip is. He's the one who came to our city to preach the gospel to us, and he's got this big-time ministry that he's going into. And so many Samaritans became believers, and he rose to prominence, and there's a great work in Philippi, Caesarea area, that many are preaching the gospel. It's so much that if you read Acts chapter 8, they send Peter and John. And they say, Peter and John, go check this out. And they do. They come, and it says in verse 13 that Simon believed. That's not the Simon we're talking about. Here, Peter, verse 14, now when the apostles of Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who when they were come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Ghost. They had yet fallen upon them. They were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. They laid their hands on them. They received the Holy Ghost. Simon saw that through the laying on of hands, and he tries to buy the gift and all of that stuff there. So they come down, and they see the church just because they heard about it. Well, being heard about it, this is big-time ministry. And so when we get to this gospel identity, things are going well for Philip. And you go, yeah. By every metric that you could measure, you're going, good, better, best. Wow, look at him. Look what he's doing. And you remember, traditional identity finds our worth in doing on these things. Now, Philip is not finding his worth there. It's small, what I put there, but as our first point. But Philip left the success because God called him. If you look down at verse 26, the angel of the Lord said unto Philip, arise and go toward the south, unto the way that goeth down from Jerusalem unto Gaza, which is desert. All right, Philip, leave your thriving ministry. Leave the city where dozens are getting saved. They're getting baptized. They're growing. I want you to leave there and go, get this, to the desert. Not a place you want to go, right? If there's ever a place that's not going to see a great church get built, right, it's the desert. Now, no, that's not true, because there's one. But he left success without losing his identity. Okay? So we get him going to, as we know the story, one person. Well, why go to one person when we can reach the thousand? Why leave a ministry that's really doing well to go reach one guy on the backside of the desert? I mean, can't somebody else go get that guy? I mean, I've got everything going good right now. Philip is called to get small. And he's called to go to one person. Now, for many, that would be defeating news. That would be like leaving the best NFL pro team with the best coach and the best record to go to the people who are working for the draft next year. Okay? And they're like 1-14. And you're going, I got to go to the, let's just say the Browns. Okay? I've got to go on their team? Really? Oh. I was doing so well here. You know, we were like Super Bowl contenders. And now we're like getting the first draft pick. Oh, yay. Okay. You know, that's not something you want to do. By every human standard, you're looking at it going, Are you sure? Because this is really going good. But he doesn't lose his sense of self. He doesn't second guess God. You see verse 27, and he arose and went. That God called him to do something, and so in that gospel identity, it didn't matter where God called him to, it didn't matter what the mission was, because it wasn't about Philip. It was about the gospel. It was about him going and doing whatever God called him to do.
Yes.
He's getting over himself to see the gospel go forward, to do what God's called him to do. We look at this story, and I will tell you, what he did from a human, fleshly standpoint is very hard. I have to leave my career. I have to leave my home that I purchased. I've got to leave my 401k. I've got to leave the security and the significance of being in this place to go to the backside of the desert. It takes a lot of guts, and it takes a lot of faith to be able to accomplish what he's doing. The second thing here is that he says himself is grounded in his assignment from Jesus. It's not grounded in, here's what's going on in our church. Here's how many people got saved. We put it on the wooden board out in the plaque. How many people came on the bus today? How many got witnessed to? How many got saved? And how many got baptized? We put it on the wall. We put it in the bulletin. We did this. We got it done. It's not anything about that. The metrics don't matter. What matters is doing what God called them to do.
Amen.
Even if it seems insignificant. Because when your significance comes from what God's called you to do, it doesn't matter what the job is. It just matters that God's called you to do it and you go forward. The third thing here is that God gave instructions as Philip obeyed. You notice in verse 26, he just said, go to the desert. He didn't tell him where. He didn't tell him who. He just said, go. Now, isn't this true that God does this in the Bible many times? That the call of Abraham is get up and leave. I'll tell you where you're going. I don't like that. Okay, I'm a guy that if we're going to go, where are we going? And when are we going to get there? And how much traffic's going to be in the way? And is there any detours? And is there, and I want all of the questions answered before I leave.
Yes.
But God calls too many times in Scripture to just go and do, and he'll give you the details as you obey. I respect Philip a whole lot more after reading this. Okay? Because I look at it and I go, I don't know that in my flesh or in my state I am that I could do what Philip did. Because I would rather know the answers, or I would rather know the details. I'd rather know that it's going to be a success before I left. This is the part of gospel identity that says, whatever God calls, that's what I'll do. And then I'll leave it up to God to work out the details. Is it God's plan or is it Philip's plan? It's God's plan, right? So if it's God's plan, does he know what's going to happen already? He does. And so Philip's obedience in it is what's going to happen. Now I want you to go down in verse 27. It says, there's a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all her treasure, had come up to Jerusalem for to worship. And so here's this eunuch. According to Jewish law, he could not enter into the temple to worship there. So I imagine that he was rejected at the temple. He's a man of great power. He's the treasurer. Okay, he's the secretary of the treasury. He's got in charge over all the money for Queen of Ethiopia, whoever she is. Okay, and so this guy's important. his entourage is probably not just his chariot. Have you ever pictured this story before? If you've ever read it in Acts 8, I always think it's like a Cinderella carriage. That's what I pictured, or like a stagecoach from Best Western and the old, Western movies. That's what I kind of think of. And then you start looking at how important this guy is, and you go, probably nicer than that, okay? This is probably the Rolls Royce of chariots as he's there. And he's returning, he's coming back, and God gives the message to him. Now, I love this. He says, go near and join thyself to this chariot. You think the entourage is going to let him get close? Okay. The people, his bodyguards protecting him, are going to let him get close. He says, go to that chariot. Remember, the message came when he got to the place. Okay. The instructions came when he got there, not when he left, but when he got there. And so Philip ran thither to him, heard him read prophet Isaiah, and said, understandest what thou readest? Do you understand what you're reading? What a book to read, by the way. Pick up Isaiah sometime and read it. I was teaching my 10th grade Bible doctrines, and I was just going through references. I said, okay, where's the prophecy of Christ being born? Isaiah. Where's the prophecy born of a virgin? Or that he's going to be great and the government's going to be there? Well, that's Isaiah. Or, well, let's keep going. Where's the book that Jesus read from when he read the prophecy? Well, that's in Isaiah. I said, where's the prophecy that Christ is going to be born in Bethlehem? They said, Isaiah. I said, no, you're wrong. And I said, that's Micah. And, they couldn't get that right. Anyway, there's a ton of stuff in Isaiah. It's 66 chapters. And it's heavy at times. And so you start reading this chapter, and he's reading it, and he says, verse 31, I love the statement, the honesty of this guy. He is a seeker of Jesus. He hasn't found him yet, but he's seeking. And I love that. God prepared this eunuch ahead of time. God put him in that place ahead of time. God had him go to Jerusalem and seek Jesus there ahead of time. I mean, this guy is just ripe fruit, ready to be picked. And so he's reading it, and he says, how can I accept a man should guide me? He desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him, so he gets into the chariot. The place of the scripture which he read was this: he was a sheep led to the slaughter, like a lamb dumb before his shearer, so opened he not his mouth. If you know your Bible, that's from Isaiah chapter 53. And what a great chapter. If you're going to lead somebody to Christ from the Old Testament, Isaiah 53 is the spot. Okay, he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Okay, we get this wonderful passage about the vicarious suffering of Jesus Christ and his willingness to go to the cross for us. And he takes him and he leads him through the Romans robe, which didn't exist. And he leads him to Christ from Isaiah 53. And the man looks at it, and here's what I love the accuracy of our Bible here, because there's some Greek manuscripts who actually leave some verses out in this. But we get verse 36. They went on their way. I'm sorry. Verse 35 is just too important. I'm sorry. So then Philip opened his mouth, began at the same scripture, and preached unto him Jesus. I love the simplicity of that statement. But he said, and they went on their way, came unto a certain water. The eunuch said, see, here is water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. He answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He commanded the chariot to stand still, and they went down both into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him. When they were come up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught away Philip. And the eunuch saw him no more and went on his way rejoicing. Philip was found at Azotus, and passing through, he preached in all the cities till he came to Caesarea. So we see some things about this encounter, and we see some future results that will come to it. So from this, let's learn some things. Okay, what can we learn Number one, the gospel fills our hearts with unconditional love and erases cultural prejudice. Cultural prejudices say this: I can't reach that group of people because I'm not that group of people. Okay? And the gospel in that is nonsense. Okay? You can reach any group of people with the gospel. But there are prejudices where people say, I won't go, and I won't speak to them because of their ethnicity, because of their race, because of their culture. I can't and I won't. And that's wrong. You see, when we're planted in the gospel, we realize this: God died for every person.
Amen.
And God loves every person.
Yeah.
And you'll see this in the gospel. It erases cultural background. You go to Pentecost and you see all the different groups of people who were there.
Yeah.
And 3,000 of them got saved. And what does Peter preach? Death, burial, resurrection of Jesus. He doesn't preach social justice. Jesus didn't preach social justice. In fact, he often went against the customs and traditions of the day to preach the gospel. The gospel erases that. Here's what I think we need in our churches. We need multicultural churches.
Amen.
Where we're all centered in the gospel. Now, I understand there are language barriers and there's all kinds of stuff that comes up, but it's one gospel that preaches. And that does for every church you find in the Bible, it unifies them. And when there is division, it's pointed out. And it says, stop it. Bring everybody together. So it erases those things. He didn't have to go to a Samaritan city. He's Jewish, but yet he goes. Okay? He doesn't have to go down into the desert to preach to an Ethiopian and then to make his way back up the coast to Caesarea to preach to the Gentiles. Okay? God doesn't have to, or Peter, Philip doesn't have to do any of that, but the gospel told him to go, and so he preached to whoever would listen. I remember in college, for our youth ministries degree, we had to go and preach at a church. And so we get a list of churches. Okay? And I had no clue what church was what church or where and anything like that. And so a friend of mine, we went twos and threes, and so two of us signed up for a church, and we went to this church. We pulled into the parking lot. It looks like a church. We went in, and we were the only two white people in that church. Okay, I will tell you this. I got a little bit, and this is in my flesh, and I was wrong in this, I got a little bit uncomfortable. And I went, where did we go? And we got up, and we both preached in that service, and I will tell you this, it changed my viewpoint. Not that I had had any racial bone, prejudice in my body there. I would be the least person of that anywhere, okay? Growing up, my parents raised me that way. But walking into that church, I will tell you this, they were welcoming of me, and they were so nice to me, and I can remember that to this day going, this is a church of people who love Christ and preach the gospel. And it changed my viewpoint. I remember our senior trip, remember we took them to Crossroads Baptist Church, and we took them up to, Garrett, you were on that trip. I'm old, wow. We went to Crossroads, remember? That's Kenny Baldwin's church, for those of you who don't know. The church. We walked in, again, there was one other youth group there, and us, and we went. Now, I knew what we were walking into. You know what that church is? People who love Jesus. Who preach the gospel. And the gospel removes all of that. We are so divided in our country today between so many things because people are pushing it. Really, if they just let it die, it would have died. Okay? But they're pushing it, pushing it, pushing it, pushing it. The gospel removes all of that. I got to move on. The gospel overpowers horizontal significance with vertical significance. Here's where we get small. Because the horizontal significance says, I've got to have my name out there, I've got to be big, I've got to have prominence, I've got to have a big ministry, I've got to see lots of people saved, I've got to have numbers, and I've got to have this. And that's the horizontal significance that says, I've got to be important and significant among my peers. And in the gospel, it removes the competition aspect of that. Now, I don't think that competition is unhealthy because I think it is in certain situations. But when it comes to the gospel, horizontal significance doesn't matter. Really, it's my relationship with Christ that does. And the gospel helps me focus on his assignment rather than personal ambition and gain. We'll get to that, I think, here in just a couple of minutes as well. But in the gospel, significance has been conferred to us. It's been given to us. We come from significance because it is God's message. It flows from us rather than us trying to be significant. Philip is not trying to get his name out there. Philip goes and God blesses. Philip goes to one person and God blesses. Philip goes up the coast and through city by city and ended up in Caesarea and God blesses. Not because Philip is the big name and significant. Really, in Jerusalem, he wasn't the big name. You got Peter, John, James, you got the apostles. Those are the big names. Those are the heavy hitters. Philip's not the big name. But yet God uses him because he's obedient. Amen. And because he doesn't care that Philip gets the credit. Acts chapter 8 is all about God getting the credit. Whether it's big or it's small, the gospel is preached. Our horizontal significance is taken away. Gospel defines success by obedience. And again, I'm just going to repeat myself here because I've already said it. But obedience is my choice. It is God's plan. And so his plan to preach the gospel, the results, the outcomes, the consequences, all of those are God's. And the more I try to manufacture that, the more I try to make it, the worse it's going to be. Because God will do the work through me if I am obedient to him. When a gospel identity is your strong anchor, you realize since you can never lose Jesus, you can lose everything else without losing self. When our anchor point is in our ability, when our anchor point is in our numbers, when our anchor point is in ourselves, when those things are rooted up one by one, which God is so good at doing, when all those are taken away, we go, what do I do now? Who am I? Where am I going? How can I survive? Because it's all about us. But when it's all about the gospel, we can lose everything and still not lose self. We love him, but we don't trust him enough to anchor ourselves in him and let him do the work. So Philip embraced smallness. He entered into a transition. He entered into a smaller, minuscule ministry that God did a great work through. Irenaeus, and this is listed in the book here, stop trying. It says, Irenaeus, a second century church pastor, tells us that Ethiopian eunuch became a missionary. He spent his life giving the gospel to Ethiopia. And it's likely because Philip was caught away at that point, he never came back to Ethiopia. He never checked on this eunuch. He never knew the results of the ministry that God gave him to that one person. Because that one person in Ethiopia got saved, how many came to gospel salvation? Because he was willing to witness to one who was not of his same race, who was not of his same culture, who was not of his same area, but went anyway, was obedient, and many came to Christ because of it.
Amen.
You'll never know the eternal significance that you'll have for Christ in this life. Just be obedient to what he's called you to do. And that's what Philip did. It's told of Philip that he went and was in Caesarea for another 25 years preaching the gospel and establishing the church there that you can still go and visit today there. Past several months, I've watched several people that I follow online, and they always end up in Caesarea. I'm going, why? Because Philip was there and preached a wonderful gospel message. All right, some more things to learn from Philip. The gospel makes us secure everywhere and anywhere. In Jerusalem, he was quiet. He was backstage. In Samaria, he was the senior pastor of a megachurch. On the road to Gaza, he was obscure. In every place, he was secure. Big, small, name and lights, insignificant, because it was all found in Jesus.
Yeah.
And he put himself in the gospel. So the gospel makes you secure wherever you are. And I can tell you this, we're all insecure in some area. My nose is too big, my ears are too wide, my voice is too high, my body doesn't match up. I'm not as good as someone else. We all have insecurities about ourselves. And when we're secure in the gospel, those insecurities when it comes to proclaiming the gospel really can melt away. Because if I put the work in God's hands and let Him do it, then it's up to Him and it's not on me. He gets to do the work. He gets the glory for it, by the way, as well. We can't decide, He did the work, now I'm going to take the credit. Okay, can't do that. Okay, God won't use you that way. But it makes us secure in every place. Got to move on. The gospel gives priority to appointments over ambition. Philip could have stayed where he was and could have preached and preached and preached, and many more come to Christ, many more saved, many more baptized, many more added to the church, many more growing, many more doing. He could have stayed right where he was and had, wow, look at Philip, look at the church. But his appointment was in Gaza. His appointment was to one person. It was not in that same place. And God did the moving. Philip wasn't looking to move. God did the moving. And He put him in the place where He wanted him. His core ambition, his deepest value was locked into what Jesus had for him. Lastly, the gospel identity gives eternal purpose to insufficient people. We seem to put apostles, disciples, preachers like Philip up on a pedestal and go, wow, what great men of God they were. Always full of faith and always did right and everything was hunky-dory, right? And yet we read Peter and Paul fighting with each other because Peter won't go to the Gentiles because he's got a prejudice against them. And we read about Moses' anger in the Bible. We read about David's lack of awareness on some things, to put it kindly, on things, lack of discernment on them in Solomon's life. And there's so many things that we look and we say, wow, what amazing men. And they all were just like you and me. They all had failures. They all had lapses in faith. They all had times where they didn't know what they were doing. They didn't always do things correctly. But the simple answer is they're people. And so whatever God called them to do, the reason we read about them 2,000 years later is because they obeyed. Mm-hmm. It's because they went where God told them to go and they did what God told them to do.
Amen.
So you may be sitting here going, I'm insignificant. Who knows where Fort Pierce is? Nobody. That's what I found out. I go to all these recruitment places. Where's Fort Pierce? We have no clue. I got to tell them it's an hour above where Donald Trump lives. Oh, okay. They still don't have a clue where we are. I actually finally made a map and said, that's where we're at. Okay. Why? Because no one knows where Fort Pierce is. You may be sitting here going, what significance do I have? I'm just a school teacher. What significance do I have? I'm just a layman in the church. What significance do I have? I don't have any name, prominence, or anything like that. Hey, get small. Hey, there's a famous baseball general manager of a team, and the whole name of his game is this, small ball. Little base hits, little stealing of bases, okay, little right time of doing things, it's all called small ball. Can we get into some small ball and just simply do what the coach tells us to do? Would you be obedient to what God calls you to do? He's called you to a person at your work. He's called you to a student in your classroom. He's called you to a person on your street, a neighbor. He's called you to an unknown person that you'll meet later on today. He's called you to preach the gospel. And whether that ends up where God does amazing things and explodes a ministry that you have and it just grows and grows and grows and grows and grows, or God puts you on the backside to talk to one person, would you embrace what God calls you to be and what calls you to do? Put yourself in gospel identity and realize it's His mission. I'm just a part of it. And then let God do the work throughout it. I'll end with this. Philip couldn't take credit for building a strong church in Samaria or leading the CFO, if you want to call him, of Ethiopia to Jesus. He was just a regular guy going where God told him to go, doing what God told him to do. Since he was content to be small, God chose him to do big things. Will you make that your mission to do the small things and then let God do the rest. Next week, we'll talk about grace and making peace in the gospel. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the time that you've given us. We ask that you'd help us in getting small, simply obeying your word. Help us in that, Lord. We sometimes want the big name, we want the big lights, we want the big ministry. But Lord, it's your work, and you are sovereign, will do what you will. Help us to be obedient in just doing it, following your guidance as Philip did. We ask to start practicing that today. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. All right, everybody, have a good day.